Good morning, everyone. Welcome to the class today. Thank you for joining. Thank you for being on time. Always appreciate that. I have started the recording of this lecture, so we will have these lectures recorded and available for others to watch and listen, and for all of us, I guess, to watch and listen. All right. We're going to, Ruben, you raised your hand. Do you have a question or did you want to say something?
Oh, sorry, Pastor. That was my mistake.
Okay. No problem. All right. Let's pray and then we'll get started, get into our class today. So let me just, Ruben, why don't you pray and we will get started.
Hallelujah. Father God, thank you, Jesus, for this beautiful opportunity that you have given us. We pray and receive the identity that you have given us, Father God, and we pray that you open the eyes of our understanding that we may know who we are in you, Lord, who you are. And Lord, I pray for your peace and your protection over every one of us as we go through this class. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Amen. Yeah. Thank you. All right. Good morning and welcome once again. All right. So this is our class on our identity in Christ. We have been making a journey to discover who we are in Christ and learn how to live out of our identity in Jesus Christ. So this is something very, very important, a study that's very, very important. That's why we purposely put it in the first semester, first year, because this is one of the main things we want every student, everyone who, you know, is part of the college, to have instilled in their hearts that this is who we are in Christ. And then we learn to live out of our identity. We learn to live out of our inheritance. And we learn to live out of the life that we have in Christ. That's how we are supposed to walk. And so this is something very, very important for all of us. Very quickly to review what we have covered so far in the introduction. We talked about the fact that God has given this revelation to the church primarily through the Apostle Paul. We find this revelation throughout the epistles as we trace the phrase in Christ, in Him, in whom, and related phrases as we trace that. Follow those scriptures throughout the epistles, we will be able to uncover this revelation, and that's what we are doing. What we have done is also put them under nice headings so that, you know, as we study, we will put them in context under specific headings so we can assimilate this truth in a systematic way. So we started talking about the new creation. So the first thing we said, okay, new creation. The Bible says we are a new creation. What does that mean? How did we become a new creation? And so we started looking at that. So I'm going to just share the PDF and we'll quickly review some of the things we have covered, and then we will go forward in this particular section. So we are all very familiar with the scripture that if anyone is in Christ, he is a new creation. And so we want to understand, you know, and to begin with, we emphasize if anyone is in Christ, anyone, that means that any person can experience this, have this happen through them can become a new creation. It's open to everybody. And so we said that to be a new creation means we receive new life from above. It's life from God has been given to us, and we have the life and the nature of God. We said, and that happens through the work of the Word of God, 1 Peter 1:23, and also by the work of the Holy Spirit, Titus chapter 3, verse 5. So the Word and the Spirit entering into our lives causes the release of God's new life, new creation life in us, because God works by His Word and the Holy Spirit of God works, causing that new life to take place. And then we said, 1 Corinthians 1:30, that because of Him, we are in Christ. That means God brought us into Christ. You know, so we didn't come into Christ because of our effort, our own efforts. We didn't come into Jesus because, you know, we joined a church or because we, you know, signed our name somewhere. No, we came into Christ because God brought us into union with Jesus Christ. God did this work. And then we said there was a creative work of God, because the Bible says we are created in Christ Jesus. We are created in Christ. So there was a creative work of God that took place when we were brought into Christ. So to create is to bring something that didn't exist before. So no, we were not just, like I said, I think we were not just remodeled or, you know, just refurbished or just given some outward change. No, we were created. I mean, something came into existence that was not there before. And we became a new creation. Then we also see the scriptures make very clear that by one Spirit, the Holy Spirit baptizes us into Christ. The Holy Spirit took us and put us into Christ, the one body, the body of Christ. Then he said that to be in Christ means to be spiritually one with Him. So I'm just quickly reviewing what we have already discussed. To be spiritually one with Jesus. So this is a spiritual union with Christ. In our spirit, we are joined to the Lord. We are one with Him. We are connected with Him. And therefore, His life flows to us in the spirit, right? So it works from our spirit and outward, changing our mind and our body, our soul and our body. So this new life begins to work from our spirit and then affects every part of our being. We also said that because we're joined, we're spiritually one with Jesus, every part of us belongs to Him. As you can see in 1 Corinthians 6, that same chapter, he's saying your body is the Lord's. Your body is a temple of God. That means every part of you, you're spiritually connected with Him, but every part of you belongs to Him and is His, and He is for every part of us. So he said that we became new creatures in our spirit. So our mind and our body needs to be worked upon. Our mind needs to be renewed and our body needs to be crucified. The flesh needs to be crucified. Although in our spirit, we have become brand new creation. That the effect of that new life has to work into our soul and also into our body and affect our body. So we looked at Ephesians 4:22 to 24. He tells us, you know, you need to be renewed in the spirit of your mind. So although we are a new man in the spirit, the new man is created in the image of God, yet the mind has to be renewed. And in our conduct, we have to put off, we have to get rid of the old way of living, right? So the new man has to affect our mind and also our conduct. We looked at that. The other thing we saw we looked at the, you know, the Greek words that are used for the English word new. So in English, we just say new. But in Greek, there are two different words that are used in relation to the new creation. One is the word kainos, which has to deal with the character, the nature of the what has come out new. The other word is neos, which has to do with something new in time, meaning something didn't exist, it has come into existence. So the new creation is both kainos and neos. It is both new in character and nature in a sense. It's also new in time. It came into existence. It wasn't there before, but it has come in now. So we said that, you know, that essentially means we're a new species, something totally new. And because of that, because we're a new creation, we also have a new identity. All right, so this is where we will pick up. We have a new identity. That means we have become something that was not there. And remember, this is spiritually, right? Spiritually. Let me just see if people are waiting outside. Sometimes I need to come back here. Let them come in. Okay. All right. I'm going to continue. Right, so we said we have a new identity, right? So spiritually and in the spiritual realm, our identity has been changed. Now, you know, as an analogy, as an example, you know, we can talk in terms of citizenship. You know, let's say if somebody belonged to a certain country, so they had citizenship in that country, and they had that was their identity as far as citizenship was concerned. Let's say they immigrate to another country and they take up citizenship there. Then, as far as their citizenship is concerned, that becomes their new identity. So, you know, whatever benefits that comes out of that, they enjoy. That is in the natural. We understand that. But something like that has happened spiritually to us. We have moved from the past into something totally new. And the Bible puts it in so many different ways. It says, we were dead. We were dead. But now in Christ, we are alive. Now this, of course, is spiritually. We were far away from God, far off. But now in Christ, we've been brought near. Spiritually, it's very close to God. Before we were aliens and strangers, but now in Christ, we are citizens and members of God's own family. We are not aliens and strangers, but we belong. We are citizens of God's kingdom. We are part of God's own family, right? We were darkness, but now we are light. So darkness was what described our past life spiritually, but now in Christ we are light. And like this, there are many more. You know, we were sinners, but now we are saints. We were guilty, but now we are justified. We are without any guilt. We were unrighteous, but now we are the righteousness of God. We were condemned, but now in Christ, we are justified. And basically, we are no longer what we used to be spiritually. So things have changed. And there are much more things which we are going to look at, which this whole study is going to unveil to us. This is who you are in Christ. Now, what I want to impress on our hearts is the Apostle Paul. He's instructing us that we must live out or live according to our new identity. Take, for instance, what he says in Ephesians 5, verse 8. He says, could somebody read that for us? Ephesians 5, verse 8, please.
For you were once darkness, but now you are light in the Lord. Walk as children of light.
Thank you. So, you know, he's saying, look, this was your past. This is your present. you are light. Live out of who you are now. Walk as children of light. In other words, how you live your life, you live out of what has happened to you now. You know, the darkness is your past. You have nothing to do with that. Now you are light. This is your new identity. You are righteous. You are blessed. You are victorious. You are an overcomer. God is for you. That's your present, you know, identity. Live out of that. Walk as children of light. So that is something very important. Now, of course, part of that process is to find out, who am I now? You know, I know who I was, but who am I now? What has God done for me in Christ? So we find out who we are now. What is ours? What is our inheritance? What have we been blessed with? What has God given to us spiritually? And then we're going to live out of that, walk as the people we are in the Lord. Walk as that. That's what we are pursuing in this course. Right? So part of learning to walk as who we are in the Lord, we must begin to change our own self-image, align it to what we discover of who we are in the Lord. Right? The way you think about yourself, the way you talk about yourself, you begin to do that aligned to who you are in the Lord. So in Christ, you are light. In Christ, you are blessed. In Christ, you are an overcomer. In Christ, you are more than a conqueror. And we're going to see all these things, right? So this is who you are in Christ. So you start thinking in that terms, thinking like that. It's okay. Hey, this is who I am. You know, our mind may want to think of how we used to be. You know, your mind thinks, oh man, this is who I am. I'm darkness. I am this, I am that. No, so you need to tell yourself, mind, no, that is gone. In the Lord, today I am in Christ. And in the Lord, I am light. And I'm going to walk as who I am in the Lord. But in order to do that, mind, first I need to start thinking in light, in line with the truth. Then I also need to talk about myself in line with the truth. So, okay, this is who I am. Sometimes you just need to tell yourself, hey, I am light in the Lord. I am blessed in the Lord. I am an overcomer in the Lord. I am victorious in the Lord. You know, and what all the things we're going to discuss, this is who I am in the Lord. You need to talk about that and declare that about yourself so that the goal is, we want to start walking or living as who we are in the Lord. Right? So we need to learn to live out of that identity. We'll talk more about this. Right? So recognize and embrace your identity and inheritance as new creation, as a new creation. Call yourself as who God has declared you to be as a new creation. Remember, who you are in Christ is who you really are. This is your true identity. Who you are in Christ is who you really are. That's your real identity. And from that, you begin to live. We begin to live our life here on earth. Okay. Now, a few more things here about the new creation. The new creation is in the image of God. It's in the image of God. So Ephesians 4:24, he says, put on. Okay, so let somebody read that for us, please. Ephesians 4, verse 24.
In that you put on the new man, which was created according to God in true righteousness and holiness.
Okay, thank you. So he says, put on the new man. The new man. Talking about this new creation that's inside us. New man, put it on, let it come out on the outside. So, you know, the phrase put on simply means, you know, like how we put on clothes. Clothes are what people see, It's visible to the exterior. So saying, let this new man, which is inside you, come out so that people can see it. But then he tells us something about the new man. He says, put on the new man, which was created. So once again, that word created, which we saw earlier in Ephesians 2 verse 10, he says, this new man was created according to God, or put it in simple English, in the image of God. So this new man is really in the image of God, meaning it's in his likeness. And he just mentions two aspects of the likeness of God, which is righteousness, holiness. But you can add to this. You can say the new man is in the image of God, which is love, which is kindness, which is holiness, which is, you know, everything that God is. This new man, that new creation, is in the image of God. So it has the nature of God. You know, that is why God can tell you and me, be holy, for I am holy. Or he can tell you and me, walk in love, even as I am love. Why is it that he can tell you and me to do that? Because he's given us, he's made us new man in his own image. If he did not give us the capacity to be like him, then that would be, you know, unjust, or it would be like teasing. You know, he says, okay, let me see if you can really do it. But he's not teasing us. He's awakening us to what is the possibility when he says, you know, you walk like me, walk in love, walk in truth, walk in holiness, walk in strength, because he's the new man is in his image, and he wants us to know that. Okay. Now, here we see 2 Peter chapter 1, verse 3 and 4. Can somebody please read that for us?
Second Peter 1, 3 and 4, as his divine power has given to us all things that pertain to life and godliness through the knowledge of him who called us by glory and virtue, by which have been given to us exceedingly great and precious promises, that through these you may be partakers of the divine nature, having escaped the corruption that is in the world through lust.
Thank you. Thank you. So he's saying God, by his divine power, has given us everything we need, all things that we need for life and godliness. That means for what we need in this life. And to godliness means to live holy, to live like him, godliness, godlikeness. So God has given to us everything we need for this life and for godliness through knowing him and he has called us to glory and virtue. And then he says, God also has given us by his power, he's also given us great and precious promises. That's his word. So that through his word, we will be partakers of the divine nature. So that's what I want us to see. We are partakers of the divine nature. So as a believer, this is who you are. You have God's life and God's nature in you. You are a partaker, or meaning a sharer. You have it, just like all the other believers. You partake of the divine nature, God's life. And therefore, we escape the corruption. The corruption is talking about the moral degradation, the moral decay that is in the world through lust, that is uncontrolled evil desires. So we escape that. We are not subject to the moral degradation that's in the world. Why? Because we are partakers of the divine nature. So this new man is created in the image of God, which means this new man is a partaker of the divine nature. You have God's nature in you. When the new man is created in the image of God, it means his nature is in you. Right? So you are actually born of God. There's another phrase there. You know, whoever believes that Jesus is the Christ is born of God. 1 John 5 and verse 1. So you're born of God. That means God gave birth to you. It means his life, his nature, his DNA is in you because you believe that Jesus is the Christ. Whoever believes that Jesus is the Christ is born of God. So you're born of God. So your inner person, your new man, is in the image of God. Right? And last 2 points here. Old things have passed away. You're back to that verse, 2 Corinthians 5:17. If anyone is in Christ, he is a new creation. Old things have passed away. Everything that had to do with my life in Adam, God is saying, it's passed away. It's like dead and gone. And I have now come into Christ. We have come into Christ. All things have become new. So all things have passed away. Just think about that. So if there were things, you know, the way I was before I came into Christ, let's say if I had a very bad temper or whatever, you know, my things that were not right in my behavior, my character, all things, I can expect that those things should no longer have control over me now. Because the Bible says all things have passed away. But here's what the devil will try to tell us to do. He will try to say, no, 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 that old person is still going to be here. He's going to be around, the old person. You were like that. You'll always be like that. But you and I might say, no, the word of God says all the things, things that had to do with my old life, are gone. I'm not going to let them attach themselves to me now. Okay. And then he says, all things are new and from God. This is the last point. And after this, we'll take questions. All things are new. And these new things are from God. He says, all things have become new. And he continues, all things now, all things are of God. So everything is new, and everything new is actually from God. It's not from the devil. It's not from your past life. Everything is new, and everything is of God. You know, sometimes we tend to think, well, this came from my past life. No, don't think like that. And don't let anything from the past try to attach itself on you. Refuse it. Because in Christ, you are a new creation. You have been created in God, in Christ. You are in the image of God. The new man is in the image of God. It has the divine nature. Everything has become new. And everything is from God. That's who you are on the inside. The old is gone. You have a brand new identity. So all things are of God. Okay, there's one more point here, sorry. So I want to close here with this thought that we need to grow into the full measure of the new creation. And you can imagine, you know, in many places in scripture, spiritual life is paralleled to the natural life. So just like a baby that is born in the natural, and the baby grows and is able to, you know, the baby has the DNA of in everything it's supposed to be, but the baby grows over time and grows into adulthood and takes on all and fully expresses what was already there in the DNA. So that's growing into the full measure, is what we're saying. So God has created you and me in his own image, and in the new creation, he's put everything there, but now we have to grow spiritually. Our spirits have to grow in the knowledge of the Lord. And it says in Ephesians 4:13 and verse 15, could somebody read these two verses, please? Ephesians 4:13 and 15 for us, please.
Till we all come to the unity of the faith and of the knowledge of the Son of God, to a perfect man, to the measure of the stature of the fullness of Christ, but speaking the truth in love, may grow up in all things into him who is the head, Christ.
Yes. Amen. So, thank you. So he's saying, no, this is a process. This is happening. We're all going to come to the unity of the faith and to knowing the Son of God. And we're going to grow to a perfect man. The word perfect man simply means a mature man, a fully grown man, a full adulthood. We're going to grow into a perfect man. And what is that perfect man? What does it, you know, adulthood look like? It's the full measure of the stature of the fullness of Christ. Or you could say it's Christ-likeness. It's becoming fully like Christ. And he kind of reiterates that in verse 15. We speak the truth in love and we grow up in all things to be like Jesus. Grow up in all things to him. Right? So that's the journey in our spiritual life. A growing up to be like Jesus. Right? So we have everything there. The DNA is there. The fullness, the nature of God is there in our spirit. We are a new creation, but our spirit has to grow up so that we can fully express Jesus Christ in our lives, right? And part of this is to grow in the knowledge of the Son of God, to grow in knowing him. Right? And as we grow in knowledge, and we're talking about revelation knowledge, our human spirit becomes stronger and grows. And we begin to reflect who Jesus is. Right? So 2 Peter 3:18 says, grow in the grace and knowledge of our Lord Jesus Christ, Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. So grace is the expression of God's character. We grow in all of these aspects, and we also grow in the knowledge of our Lord Jesus Christ. So to sum it up, you know, the reason God brought us into Christ so that we could be like Christ. We would be like Jesus. We would walk like him and represent him fully here on earth. So I'm going to pause here. And we're just going to have a time for questions and you know, just interact on anything that we want. Anybody here, you have any questions, you're welcome to either ask it or you can type it in the chat and we will take up questions. All right. First question there, Divya. So the ignorance of the knowledge of the glory of God, mainly what God has done, can also limit a believer from walking in this new identity in Christ. Yes. So ignorance, you know, not knowing what God has done for us, right? That is actually the biggest problem. Because many people don't know, right? I mean, many of us have copies of the Bible, but we haven't discovered what is in those pages and how to live out of that. That's the biggest problem, right? The ignorance of that. So we need to share the revelation. We need to make it known and help people understand that, look, right here in the Bible, God has done so much for us. God is telling us, I have done all this for you, and I want you to live out of that. And so we need to make it known so people begin to know it and then embrace it, say, yeah, it's for me, I'm taking it, I'm going to live by it. And then we journey into it, and, you know, we start expressing more and more who we are in Christ. OK. Okay.
Thank you, Pastor. I had just one more question. So is that knowledge, as you were mentioning, is it that revelation knowledge? Like, I know how to apply it.
Mm-hmm. Right. So we use the word revelation knowledge to distinguish from simple intellectual knowledge. Intellectual knowledge means people are just studying it as an intellectual thing, you know, to gain information. So somebody could literally study the Bible from an intellectual perspective or an historical perspective or as a literary perspective. Let me study the Bible as a literary book. You know, so people study or read the Bible from so many different perspectives, and they may have good knowledge of the information in the Bible. But when we say revelation knowledge, it's something that our spiritual eyes have been opened to see spiritual truth. Right? When this is spiritual reality, it grips our hearts and it says, and we say, God, this truth is going to change my life. But that's revelation knowledge. So it's beyond just intellectual comprehension of the Word of God. It is spiritual understanding of the Word of God. And that's what is going to change our lives. Right?
Thank you so much, Pastor.
You're welcome. Let's see now. All right, then we have another question. That all things have become new. But we are new creation, but sometimes it happens that old person manifests from somewhere inside, digging or myself. Okay. So thank you, Robert, for sharing that. So, you know, so basically Robert is sharing a common thing that all of us would have struggled with, where we know we've become new creation, but just as an example, let's say in the past, anger was a problem. Now we have become a new creation and we still seem to be very angry or with people and, you know, get very upset. So why hasn't that changed? Well, we know we've become a new creation in our spirit, but our soul, which is our mind, will, and emotions, and our body needs to be brought in subjection to the spirit, the new creation. Right? So that is where, that's what we must learn to do. That when my soul, my emotions are agitated because maybe somebody spoke rudely to me or somebody irritated me, whatever, you know, they could have done that. And obviously in the soul, we are agitated. But that is when we must learn to live out of the spirit. So for a simple thing is to say, you know, at that moment, you just say, Father, I know I feel like this. I feel very upset or irritated or whatever, but Lord, I thank you that the love of God is poured into my heart by the Holy Spirit. And I'm going to walk in love. I'm going to do what love will do in the situation. So it's a simple saying, I'm going to live by who I am in the Spirit rather than react based on how I'm feeling in my emotions. Yes, I'm not denying how I feel. I am irritated or I'm upset or disturbed or whatever, agitated, whatever, because of what has happened around me. That's how I feel in my soul. But at the same time, I know who I am in the spirit. In the spirit, I've been created in the image of God. God is love. The love of God is in me and I am in him. I can walk in love. So I'm making the choice. I say, Father, right now, I'm feeling very upset or disturbed, but I want to walk in love. I want to do what love will do. And that just one moment, making the choice, will change everything. Because the love of God, God is going to empower you and me to walk in love. And you will do what love will do in that situation. So instead of retaliating or having an outburst of anger, you know, you just talk very peacefully and say, okay, never mind, you know, we will handle this later or whatever. You will respond in the love of God. And that is putting on the new man. You know, people see the new man expressed in the outer man. Right? So we make the deliberate choice to tap into who we are in Christ, who we are in the Lord. We are walking as who we are in the Lord, what we have in the Lord. We are living out of that. So you make that deliberate choice. Does that help, Robert? Is it, you know?
Yes, Pastor, it helps very much. Thank you.
You got an idea. Try it out. You know, it's a simple thing to practice. But when you begin to do that and that you make that your way of life, you know, you will see. Yeah, wonderful. You are basically putting on the new man. That's what the Bible is telling us to do. Okay?
Thank you.
Now, welcome. Let's take this question from Zelitoli Watsa. Okay? I hope I pronounced your name correctly. The question is, what is the ministry of reconciliation mentioned in 2 Corinthians 5:18? Can you explain? Sure. So, you know, so Paul begins this, actually, if you back up to verse 16, you know, he says, look, Christ died for us. Therefore, this is how we think. If Christ died, gave his whole life for us, then we should give our lives for other people. And so he says, you know, we are a new creation in Christ. And, you know, everything is of God. Therefore, we don't relate to people. Verse 18, we don't. Verse 16 now. So we don't relate to people purely on natural terms. And then he says in verse 18, God has reconciled us to himself through Jesus, and he's given to us the ministry of reconciliation. And he goes on to explain that in verses 19 and 20. That is, God is, not only have we been reconciled to God, but he's using us as his agents to bring a world that is lost, to bring the world to himself. So that's why he calls us as ambassadors for Christ. That's in verse 20, right? That means we are representing Christ. We're ambassadors for Christ in this world. So we are a new creation. Everything has changed. And now God is using us as agents of change in this world. We are people who call the world to be reconciled to God. So we have experienced transformation. Now we are agents of transformation in the world, bringing the world back to God. And we're announcing to the world that God is not angry with them. Right, so he says this, you know, God is, verse 19, God is not imputing their sins against them. You know, our message is a message of reconciliation. I'm not saying God is angry with you, but God wants you to come to him. Right? That's the ministry of reconciliation, which all of us have as new creation. Okay, we have a separate section that we will be dealing with on our ministry as new creation, and this is part of that. We will be talking about it again some more. Isaac, so Zeloti, what's, I hope that explains. Isaac, now as we're in Christ, we are a new man spiritually, but there's a constant battle between our spirit man, our mind and body. What can we do to subject the mind and body under the full control of the spirit? Good question. So Isaac, this is a good question. How do we bring our mind and body under control of the spirit? I'll give a very, you know, some concise answer now. But coming up then later in another section, we're going to talk about identification, where we kind of get into the details of what we're supposed to do with the flesh. And then we're going to talk about life in the spirit life. What do we do and how do we do it, right? But to answer your question very concisely, the soul needs to be renewed, or the mind needs to be renewed. This is Romans chapter 12 and verse 2. The Bible says we have to renew our mind. Why? Because in our mind, we've been trained to think according to our old life. But now we've become a new creation. So we need to train our mind to think according to the new creation. So we need to renew our mind. That means change the way we think with the word of God. Right? So that's one very important thing. The Bible tells us to renew our minds. Second, with our body, with the flesh needs to be crucified. Right? That means the natural evil desires. So our body is the temple of God. Not everything about our body is bad or wrong, but our body still has natural evil desires. And the body was, you know, has been used to doing wrong things. So the flesh needs to be crucified. So a concise answer to your question is, we must continually renew our mind with the word of God, change our thinking to think in terms of the word of God. And we need to crucify the flesh, learn to keep the flesh in subjection to the Holy Spirit. This is where the Holy Spirit comes in. When we talk about the spirit life or life in the spirit, we will understand that. And that's how we deal with the soul and the body. Okay, this is a short answer. We'll be getting into much detail in the upcoming sections. Okay, let me take one more question before we go for our break. Rosalind says, 2 Peter 3:18, grow in the grace and knowledge of our Lord Jesus. How do we grow? All right. So we can, you know, use the analogy of the natural, of natural growth to help us understand spiritual growth. In the natural, to grow, we need to, you know, feed or nurture, feed ourselves. We need to be active. You need to exercise, do, you know, do things. We need interactions with people. We need to, you know, interact with people. And then of course, rest is also necessary. So you feed, you exercise, you interact, you rest. Generally speaking, right? In the natural, for a person to grow, for a person to mature, these four things usually happen. So similarly, spiritually, we need to feed ourselves with the word of God. We need to exercise ourselves. That means we need to live, practice the word of God, just practice it, do it. We need to interact, which is we need fellowship with God's people. We need to be amongst God's people, learn from each other, sharpen each other. We need that fellowship. And fourthly, we need rest. Spiritual rest is just being in God's presence, in prayer, in worship, and so on. So if you just draw the parallel from the natural to the spiritual, it kind of gives us, okay, you need to do these four things to grow. You need to feed yourself. You need to exercise. You need to practice the word of God. You need to interact. You need to fellowship with other believers. And then you need rest. You need to be in the presence of God in prayer and waiting on him in worship. And so these four things will help us grow in grace and in the knowledge of our Lord Jesus Christ. Is that okay, Roslyn? Just a quick answer. Okay, good questions. Thank you for asking. And we are definitely going to look into many of these things as we go forward. Okay, so we're going to take a quick 10-minute break, and we will get into our next section after the break. You can download the PDF of the next section.